Dr. Salem. My testimony is that I consulted with Dr. Salem as part of the process to try to make sure that I did everything to ensure that the gas would not produce permanent harm to children or
the
elderly.
Was that the only study you did?
That was the person that I talked to. I also consulted because they were there at the same time with the commander.
Part of the British study that was testified here, they gave us descriptions of symptoms of overexposure of the CS, producing excessive salivation, congestion of the nose wall and the pharynx, a feeling of suffocation, and first and possibly second degree burns in sensitive people. The report further quotes the U.S. Army Chemical Research and Development Center that they know of no laboratory studies that have ever been conducted with CS that utilized that have been utilized on children as subjects. They also state that the Army databases contain virtually every study on CS that has ever been conducted by any government or private facility in the world. Knowing that your first concern was for the children, I find it difficult to understand how after extensive, exhaustive research, you fail to uncover the following information that I uncovered in just one day. A report contained in the Journal of American Medical Association dated August the 4th, 1989. That states, I quote, inhalation and toxicology studies at high levels of CS exposure have demonstrated its ability to cause chemical pneumonitis and fatal pulmonary edema. According to an ear and nose and throat surgeon that I talked to, pulmonary edema is caused when the mucous membrane is irritated. It secretes mucus, which in children and infants plugs up the bronchi. They thus drown in their own saliva and mucus. As soon as the child breathes the fumes, the process begins. Soon after that, the child has little lungs left to breathe and dies. I find it impossible to believe that the most powerful law firm in the country, the Department of Justice, at your disposal, you could not find this information out. That I found out in one day with two staff members.
But on Sonny's case, I had delivered, as a matter of fact, it was related to originally the, I believe, probably one of my journeys to Washington, talking to some of the Dante Fisel's people, doing or Henry Gonzalez. I did things relative to the finances when he was connected with the investigating some of the financial garbage going on. He was a congressman out of Texas. The bottom line was somehow we crossed paths, I crossed paths in Washington with one of the guy that ran Sonny's offices, Sonny Bono. And I told him I was working on this major thing connecting the CIA and drugs. Now, this was after the Waco events and all of that stuff. Sonny had become so traumatized when he got up to Washington. You know, again, he knew about corruption, but he was destroyed when he started finding out how high it went and how deep it went and how extraordinary it was relative to billions and multi-millions of dollars.
I'm going from memory, but didn't he break down and cry over Waco?
Absolutely.
And stuff?
Yes, he did.
And I remember watching him on C-SPAN because I was addicted to C-SPAN at that time, and he was really starting to get in people's faces, and you could tell he was freaking out that he was in the middle of a bunch of crooks.
Yes, he did. He actually broke down and cried. You know, you can look at that from two sides. His life and mine were so terribly familiar. I did things in the record business that he did in the record business. He, of course, became much more famous, but nonetheless, he and I ran down mutual railroad lines side by side, like you and I. But anyhow, to get back to what took place there, so I told Sonny was looking into the narcotics, etc., and of course Maxine Waters was doing her theatrical thing relative to it on the floor of the Congress. screaming and yelling about the connections. So I, at that time now, I was in living in Los Angeles. All right, this is early 90s. I had moved to L.A., and Congressman Waters' offices were right close by. I contacted them, and I said, I'm going to finish this report in a couple of weeks. I'm going to give it to you. And I said, now, this names names that you're not going to want to talk about, you know. And they said, which, of course, I heard that before, they said, oh, we don't care. Wherever the chips fall, you know, in the name of honesty, you know, and I thought, yeah, ha-ha on that one. So I supplied her with a copy of this, her offices, and I supplied Sonny. Now, Sonny took a couple of months. In that interim period of time, Waters slowed down and was no longer screaming and yelling about the narcotics being supplied to the streets of America by our high-level government.
Somebody had gotten a message to her, because she was on the news before that, I remember.
Right.
She was going and confronting the CIA director, Mike Rupert was. That was big news then.
Right, and Mike and I are good friends, too, by the way. But okay, so we go. So she did nothing. As a matter of fact, part of that, believe it or not, something that was missed, but Greenspan, Alan Greenspan, visited her, walked the streets of her backyard in California, in Southern California, and promised her $100 million, if I remember right, financial assistance. Now, I don't know where the heck he's supposed to get that assistance, but they got an awful lot of community assistance exactly in this period of time. I'm talking within a couple of weeks of what I'm talking with the report, and that was the end of her. She never complained anymore. So not to say that that was directly related, but it's very possible.
And for those that don't remember, the inner city areas were turned into war zones when the CIA started bringing the crack in, and there were actual people so drugged out they wouldn't eat or even drink, that looked like zombies with all their hair falling out, literally, because I grew up in Dallas and saw a lot of these. They look scarier than actual, you know, fake zombies in movies. So I could see why she was wanting to get the drugs stopped being shipped in. But, I mean, that's like putting a Band-Aid on an axe wound to say, oh, here's $100 million for community stuff.
Yeah, I think actually she wanted to just get the credit. I don't know whether she really had a lot of care for that, but for that area. Okay, so I supplied my report to Sonny, and by the way, which is one of the ones that I have available at my website, and that's the one on, it's titled Government, excuse me, it's titled The CIA and Drugs, et cetera, et cetera. I supplied this in a DVD form. Sonny finally got to look at it. He got back to me. I received an advance, information that Sonny had gone over it. He had freaked out and was moving forward to initiate a congressional inquiry based on primarily what I had supplied him with. And there's specifically a few people that he wanted to go after. I said, great, let me know how that happened, what's going on with it. Another month went by or whatever, and I received the call right in the middle of December, and I was told, Bob, Sonny has it all set up. In 3 weeks, when he comes back from the Christmas holidays, we're going to begin the inquiry into all these characters and everything that's going on. We want to make sure you're going to be a witness and that you will assist us to go from there forward. I said, absolutely. I'm in Los Angeles now, but when you need me, you let me know, and I'll be in Washington, and let's go and do it. And the big deal was that Sonny had said that they had set up subpoena powers for the congressional inquiry. Now, this may not mean anything, it's just a word to a lot of people, but the bottom line is that commonly, with all of these inquiries that are by Congress and Senate, they're shut down all the time. They're sidestepped. We are lied to. They come in. They have experts that come in and sit on the committees. They know how to shut up everything.
Well, here's an example. The TSA ordered Congress not to have all these top forensic security experts testify, proving their machines are frauds and it's all theater. And they tell, that was in the news the other day, the TSA tells Congress, and Obama tells Congress what he can and can't do. He tells Congress, hey, we're going to have a war, and you're not over that. The UN is now.
Yes, absolutely. So the total control thing by this time, just forget about it. Anybody that thinks you're going to get anything done, you know, like the idea of write your congressman, phew, give me a break. That's almost a comedy routine. But let me get to the most upsetting thing in 30 years in my life, I think, was the Sonny situation. So what happened is he gets my report. They're going to move forward with the subpoenas. Subpoenas means that they're going to be able to tell these people to answer the questions or do jail time for not answering the questions. That's the difference that Sonny had set up. He was going to be on this new intelligence committee. It was all, everything was set and in place. And so I said, great. I wished them all a nice Christmas, and that was it. 10 days after I received that telephone call, Sonny Bono was murdered on the top of the ski slopes. Period. End of story. When it happened, totally freaked me out, because the bottom line is I genuinely feel somewhat responsible for his death, because I know the materials I sent him and the phone call I had gotten 10 days earlier was the last straw for the bad guys. They were in a position to either stop, and actually they had to kill and terminate Sonny before he came back, which would have been about 10, 15 days after he was killed. They only had 10, 15 days left. If they hadn't killed him, and where he was going to move forward with the investigation would have been started, and somebody would have finished it, even if he had been killed then.
Incredible. Incredible. Going back to Bob Fletcher of BobFletcherInvestigations.com. Finishing up with the Sonny Bono, because I want to spend a little bit of time with you. And then if you want, we'll have you back next week or the week after to really get into weather weapons and everything I originally wanted to get you on with. But I remember 93, 94, watching Access TV, people putting Bob Fletcher investigation videos on. And it was just, I was like, this guy's really credible. I've seen him on C-SPAN testifying to Congress, but then he's talking about weather weapons. That was just too far out for me. Now it's just, oh, the government's weather modifying, but it's secret. And it's everything Bob exposed, so I'm going to do a whole hour with him on how he knew all that. But finishing up with Sonny Bono's murder.
Okay, sure enough. We end up running out of time because we're talking 30 years of crazy stuff here. So with Sonny's case, I called Sonny's office right away to my longtime associate up there for a few years, he would not take my calls. Now, this is a guy I normally would eat lunch with in Washington, and so this was right afterwards. So then I knew I was right. The worst situation had happened, that he had been hit. So I started chasing it, and I had done a profuse inquiry. It took me a long time. They were totally withholding the autopsy reports, which I guess I'm still the only guy that's gotten it. They're holding a little bit of it back, but the autopsy in reality shows that he had. There's no way he could have run into the tree. That's all baloney. I got the footage of the area that was taken only a couple hours after he was found, and all the rest of that. I did an extensive, I've done a DVD report, which is available at my website also, on Sonny's murder. But the bottom line, without getting into all the intricacies of it, there's no question it was impossible for him to go fast enough. He was 120 feet inside inside the tree line where it was off of the ski run. He was up actually in the woods.
What did they do? Like taser him and then drag him in and beat his brains out? Or what did they do?
You know, that part I'm not positive. It's one of two things. Either they had a deal somehow to like meet him. It's possible somebody told him they were going to give him information for his investigation, meet him secretly there. Or he was hit someplace else and brought up on a ski sled and then rolled over into the snow and dragged up against the tree. But he was pistol whipped on the right side of his head, probably by a left-handed assassin.
Yeah. But they said on the news, Benazir Bhutto hit her head. She's on tape being machine gunned. We'll be right back.